My name is Uma Sawant. I currently work at LinkedIn, but I'm going to talk about something that I worked on while I was doing my PhD. So the title of the talk is Needle in a Haystack, Entity Search on Text and Graph. All of us use web search engines to find answers to our query. Now, the search engine gives us a set of documents, and we are expected to go through these documents to find the answers. What if the answer was directly presented to us? Doesn't that just upgrade your search experience? So, entity search builds upon this philosophy. It's trying to find the needle for you out of the haystack of documents. So, after this talk, I am hoping to leave you with an awareness of this different flavor of search. And if you are a search practitioner, I hope you can carry back some of the insights which you can use to upgrade your own search engines. These are the names of my collaborators. This is an ongoing search project at IIT Bombay. I'll first talk about some of the background. What are entities? What is entity search? Why that is relevant? Followed by a deep dive on the technical details. And then we'll go over some of the experiments we did and
some insights that came out of those experiments. All right. So first question is, what are these entities I'm talking about? Simply put, entities are objects of interest. So those could be people like Sachin Tendulkar. Those could be locations, movies, monuments, phones, cars, universities, and so on. Any object of interest. Entity search is a search engine that takes in a text query and presents results in terms of these objects. So for example, if my query is Brad Pitt movies, I don't want to see documents, I want to see a carousel over movies. If my query is universities India, again, I expect to see a carousel over colleges and universities. So in this case, my entities are movies and universities. Research shows that at least a quarter of today's web search queries are actually seeking entities. So if we can do a better entity search, we can really upgrade the search experience. What are these queries? So some examples are Bahubali lead roles, fastest ODI double century, main oncology universities India, and which phones have unsafe batteries. Now at this point, somebody may ask, aren't today's search engines already doing some of it? Yes, they are. But there are two main problems as we see today. First, the lack of coverage. Although, as I said, at least a quarter of web search queries are seeking entities, they're still being answered in terms of documents. If I query for main oncology universities India, document results. If I query for which phones have unsafe batteries, again, document results. The second main problem that we see today is lack of robustness. For very similar formulation of queries, I see entity results versus document results. If I query for murder books, Agatha Christie, I get a nice carousel over books, which is what I want. But if I query for murder mysteries, Agatha Christie, I fall back to document answers. And if you notice, the actual results, the actual entities I'm looking for are mentioned in the top results, yet they are not extracted out there. So one question is, why does that happen today? So one main reason these kind of problems come up is because today's search engines are dependent on what is known as the knowledge graph for doing question answering. So if you attended Professor Partha's talk yesterday, you would have heard something about knowledge graphs. So what are knowledge graphs? Very simply, these are a collection of facts about entities. So they contain types and relations and entities presented in the format of a graph. So here is one example. Here is a very simple knowledge graph. It has two entities, Prabhas and Bahubali. These entities are of type actor and fill, and these are connected via the relation acted in. So to give you some examples of public and proprietary knowledge graphs, our Wikipedia is a type of knowledge graph. DBpedia, which is derived from Wikipedia, again, another knowledge graph. Then there is Freebase, Yago, Wikipedia, NEL, that is never-ending learning that Professor Partha mentioned yesterday. These are all public knowledge graphs that you can use. In terms of proprietary knowledge graphs, our LinkedIn has its own knowledge graph of people and their skills and their jobs, so on. Google has a very nice knowledge graph. Microsoft has Satori. Facebook has its own knowledge graph of people and their connections and so on. Right. So let's get back to why do today's search engines do not perform well when it comes to entity search. As I said, most of them are dependent on these knowledge graphs for question answering. However, to answer the questions based on knowledge graphs, you have to translate the text query, such as Bahubali lead roles, into a query which can be executed on this graph. So let's say it can be a query like select an entity E, where E is connected to entity Bahubali via the relation acted in. Now, this approach works best when your translation is right. You get fast and precise answers. The bad part about this approach is that when clause. It's not always easy to come up with the right translation for your input query. Let me give you an example. Suppose my query is fastest ODI double century. Okay, it's a very simple query if you think about it. But if I were to execute this on a knowledge graph, I'm assuming that there is a relation of cricketers and their double centuries, and then I have to do a sort on it. So for a search engine, to do this on a large scale is difficult. There are many tail queries, like fastest ODI double centuries, where you would not be able to do the right translation. And that's where you come up with the problems of low coverage or lack of robustness. And the second problem, which also was mentioned yesterday, is building knowledge graphs is a very hard problem. So very talented people have been working on this problem, building open source knowledge graphs for many years, right? Intuitively, it's not easy to cram all the knowledge in the world into one knowledge graph, which is why knowledge graphs will always have a lack of coverage. There may be missing entities, nodes, or relations. And that's why when you do question answering on top, you get coverage issues. So our goal here is to create a dedicated entity search engine, which will do better than this. It will have good coverage. It will be able to answer the queries, as I mentioned. At the same time, it will have good robustness and accuracy. All right, so that was the background. I hope the problem statement is clear to everyone. Let's do a deep dive now on the technical details. So we said that, yes, knowledge graph-based question answering works, yet it has some of the problems, such as coverage and robustness. How are we planning to do better than that? So one obvious solution that may have come to your mind is why not we go and append some of the information to the knowledge graph, right? So suppose extraction is hard, relation extraction is hard, maybe we will mention the relation in phrases form, right? Sure. So there are many such approaches where you go on increasing the coverage of the knowledge graph. At the same time, your accuracy of the facts inside knowledge graph goes down. So there are various methods which work on different incarnations of this at end of the spectrum. We thought, why not go all the way? Suppose we will use all the information that is there in conjunction with the knowledge graph. And what is that source going to be? That is going to be the corpus of all the web documents. Okay, so that's the main idea behind this talk. We are going to use the web documents in conjunction with knowledge graphs. How do we connect the web documents to KGs? To give you an example, at the top, I have the knowledge graphs, as I mentioned before, about films, Bahubali, actor, Prabhas, and Rana Raghubati. I have some of the web documents here below, which, for example, one document says, Bahubali leads Prabhas as Shivendu, Rana Raghubati as Ballala, and so on. Now, if you notice, this document contains mentions of the same entities which are mentioned in the graph. So there is Bahubali mentioned here, Prabhas mentioned here, Rana Raghubati mentioned here. We are going to connect the mentions of these entities with the actual nodes in the graph, resulting in what is known as the entity annotated text. So we have created these links. How do we create these links? Using entity annotators. So more about that later. So at this point, we have a query coming in from the left, Bahubali lead roles. We want to have an entity answer in terms of entities. And in between, we have these connected information sources, knowledge graph, and web documents. And that's our entity search engine. All right. So how do we use these two information sources effectively? So the first part I'll talk about is how to match the query with the structured knowledge graphs. So very simply, the query is a collection of words, right? If I want to answer that query in terms of entities, the hints to what entities I'm looking for are mentioned in the query in terms of entities, types, or relation. My job is to extract those hints and map them to the nodes on the knowledge graph. So how do we do this? We first go and tag entities in the input query text. So given the query Bahubali lead roles, I use an entity tagger to identify an entity. For example, here it's Bahubali. I go and pin it on the knowledge graph. As a second step, I look at all paths on the graph starting with this entity. So this is an example of one path. There may be one path here, and so on. So all these paths have entities, types, and relationships. And these are the candidate translations of the input query. So my next job is to take all these candidate translations and try and match them with my input text query. How I'm going to match them is I'm going to identify the type matches and the relationship matches. So let's see that one by one. Okay, so for, as I said, we first identify the entity mentioned in the input query. Here is one open source tool that we use called TagMe. Now TagMe is trained using Wikipedia, where since Wikipedia already has words marked with their source documents, which are the source entities, it uses that as training data and trains a machine learned model. Now, if you give any input text to it, it will be able to identify entities for you. So here is a snapshot of how we use TagMe on the input text, Bahubali, Kaas, Prabhas, Ashwindu, and so on. So it's able to identify that word Prabhas is actually a link to the entity Prabhas. Right? So using TagMe, we first identified the entities. Then the next question came is, how are we going to match the input query text to the types and relationships on the knowledge graph? So for that, we built our own convolutional neural networks. If you are not familiar with them, do not worry. Just think about this as a multi-class, multi-label classification, right? So on the left-hand side, we have a query coming in, query in terms of words. On the right-hand side, your classifier is going to output scores for each type or for each relation. So if one of the candidate types is actor, it's going to have one score here. What is happening in between is, first, the query is represented, each query word is represented as a vector. Then there are some convolutional and pooling layers, which give you a fixed size representation of the input query. So these are feature representations of the query. We also appended manual query and type word overlap features. So we found out that not just outsourcing everything to CNN, if we can input our own simple TF-IDF type of features, it actually works better. So we did that. At this layer, we have our a feature representation of the query, and then we have a classifications layer sitting on top. Right. So at this point, we have an entity. Entities marked in the query text, and we are able to identify the match between the types mentioned in the query, relations mentioned in the query, with those mentioned on the graph. So this was about query to knowledge graph match. So just to make sure you're all with me, I'm just presenting the way of computing features between query and its translation. How is actual machine learned model is going to behave? I haven't talked about that. That is yet to come. So just hold that thought. All right. So given a query, we are able to match it with the knowledge graph. At the same time, we said that we'll also use web documents for doing question answering. So how is that going to happen? Let's look at that next. As I said, we have entity annotated web text. So this web text has mentions of entities tagged with the original entity. So this word Prabhas is actually tagged with my node called Prabhas in my knowledge graph. The way this I do question answering based on this entity annotated web text is, first I identify text snippets which have query words mentioned. So if my query is Bahubali lead roles or Bahubali lead cast, I'm going to identify all the snippets in which one or more of these query words mentioned. So here is one example. At the same time, I'm also looking for all the entities which are again mentioned in these snippets. So one snippet where it all comes together is Bahubali cast. So these are query words, and Prabhas is an entity which is tagged. So this is a potential candidate snippet. My next task is, since there will be thousands or tens of thousands of such snippets, I have to score each of these, right? So some of them may be false positives. Words just came together by chance. These do not indicate answers, right? So here we use, again, a CNN to identify which snippets are correct, or identify a score for each snippet to give me an answer. So what are the features that it's going to use? It's going to use the distance between the query words and the entity word, and the TF-IDF, the IDF score of those words. Right. So using all that, this is the CNN that we ended up using. This was taken from the research work done by Severin et al. In 2015. So here is the text document, which is the text snippet. Here is the query text. So Bahubali lead roles will come here, and here is the text snippet. Internally, again, it's going to use convolutional and pooling layers to come up with a fixed size feature representations. It's again going to use some additional features, coming up with a total feature vector, followed by your own classification layer. So when we have this CNN, it's going to give us match between one particular snippet coming from the web documents and the query text. There are going to be tens, thousands such snippets, each possibly mentioning this, the same entity or a different entity. We are going to sum up the scores over each to give us one final score for a candidate answer, such as Prabhas. To put it all together, at this stage, I have the query coming in from left. For each query, we found some translations on the knowledge graph. So maybe type equal to actor is one. Maybe entity equal to Bahubali and relation equal to acted is another. And in parallel, there were some text snippets coming in from the web documents. Each of them connect to one or more candidate answer entities. And my job is to look at all this data and come up with the final answer. Now, if you recall, at this point, we were able to compute the match between query text and the type or the entity or the relations, as well as the web text, right? So at this point, we have these feature vectors sitting on these edges. And these feature vectors are my types match score, entity match score, relation match score. So how do we use these to come up with the final ranking is the question. So if I had access to a lot of wealth, I could actually hire labelers, experts, which will take a query, identify the best translation of that query. I would do this for tens and thousands and millions of queries and build a machine learning model on top. However, that doesn't work. Of course, I do not have access to all that wealth. And secondly, it's very difficult to come up with the right translation of the query. Sometimes you would think that actor is the right type, but maybe the type actor is not connected to my answer entity. Maybe is the type person is connected to my answer entity. How is the labeler going to know that, right? So there are all these questions, which is why we decided to not create this kind of fine-grained label data. Instead, we went with weak supervision. So by weak supervision, I mean that I'm not looking at right query translation. I'm just looking to identify the right answers for the query. So given a query, Bahubali lead role, the labelers are going to tell me that Prabhas and Rana Daggubati are some of the correct answers. There may be more, but I'm not looking for to tell very fine-grained translation such as entity equal to Bahubali, type equal to actor. That is hard. And how do we do question answering using this supervision? We use something called as latent variable discriminative model. So again, do not worry about the math. What this slide is telling us is that given a query, a feature vector, so my entity type scores are sitting here, just choose the best translation at this point. So my model is getting trained. At every stage, you have all the translations laid out, assign some score to each, and just choose the max scoring in query translation. And make sure that you find me a weight vector such that the right answer, the positive answer entity, scores greater than the negative answer entity. To put it in pictures, find me a weight vector, this is my classifier, such that the right answer, Prabhas, scores higher than the one of the wrong answers, maybe Prabhakar, with the help of the best scoring interpretation at that point. And this process goes on iteratively. Since this is max greater than max kind of constraint, this is a non-convex problem, it terminates at a local minima. That's the best we could do. This is the total objective function, translation of what I just spoke in mathematical terms. All right. So that was about how we are going to solve the problems. Before we move on to the experimental section, are there any questions? Yes. Wow. Right. So the question is, we did question answering assuming that Prabhas already exists as an entity in my catalog. Is that the right part? Yeah. So how are we going to know that suppose Prabhas doesn't exist in my catalog, there may be some other entities which do not exist. How do we do question answering on top? Right. So in this work, we are assuming that at least the entities are correctly present in the knowledge graph. They are maybe noisily marked in the web text. So we are making that assumption. This work will be able to help you if the relations are not marked well or if the types are not marked well. So that's one assumption we are making. To answer the second part of the question, what to do in case the entities are not marked, which this work doesn't handle. So if you attended Professor Partha's talk today, he was talking about never-ending learning, NEL. What they do is they rely on the surface forms of entities or types of relations. So those kind of words where you would get approximate answers in terms of surface form. So you do not have to know that Prabhas is an entity. This is a word which potentially indicates your entity, and then there are some techniques which will be able to find out those words and phrases for you. So maybe you want to look up Oren Edzioni's works, or just look up NEL. Yeah, okay, maybe we'll take one or two more questions and then move on to experiment.
Hey, okay, so I had a question, like, what are the embeddings that you're using? Do you generate yourselves, or like, are you using some sort of database for the embeddings? Or the
question is whether I'm using some database of embeddings, yeah, or whether I'm generating, right. So we actually used glove vectors to seed our embeddings, but they were also tuned to our training data. So those were warm started with glove. Yes, we are back. Just one last question, then maybe we'll take more questions at the end.
Yeah, here.
Yes.
Yeah, knowledge graphs are particular, subjective to one particular domain, or you build knowledge graphs for each domain?
Right. I gave examples of knowledge graphs which were proprietary. So LinkedIn's, for example, is going to be a professional knowledge graph, right? It's maybe you are building a product catalog. That is a domain-specific KG related to e-commerce. What we are working with are open source knowledge graph or open domain knowledge graph, which are trying to capture information from all domains, right? Not specific to a particular domain. All right, so I'm going to move on to experimental section. Let's finish this and then we can take more questions. All right, so I gave examples of few knowledge graphs. Earlier, we are going to use one of those free-based knowledge graphs. It has 29 million entities, around 14,000 types, and around 4,600 relations. We used CLUWeb09 as the webpage corpus. So this is a corpus released by CMU. It has 50 million pages. Google took this and annotated it with entities, releasing what is known as the FACC1 corpus. So there are, on an average, 13 entity annotations per page. For measuring the ranking performance, we use the mean average precision measure. And sometimes we sliced the ranking, took the top K and converted it to a set. At that time, we used F1 as the performance measure. And this code and generally the project is available at my advisor's website. You can take a look at this link. All right, we use four different query sets. Some of them were in keyword format, some of them were in natural language format, resulting in about, in total, 8,000 queries. So the first question we wanted to answer was, sure, we went through all this trouble to add an additional source of knowledge, which is the web text. How are we, are we actually improving the performance? So we did a set of experiment where we use only the web text for question answering, we use only the knowledge graph for question answering, and finally when we use both. So thankfully, as we surmised, we are doing better when we use both knowledge sources. So here the blue bar indicates experiments where we use only the knowledge graph, the green bar where we use only the web corpus, and the red bar where we are using both. So under different set of conditions, different experiments we ran, different models we used, when we always found better performance when we use both the knowledge sources. Some examples where why this works better. If the query is Bahubali lead roles, so suppose erroneously my model chose the type as lead alloys, okay, and it also chose web text where an entity solder of type lead alloy is mentioned, and one of the query words role is also mentioned. However, there are not going to be too many snippets in which this is happening, and also an important query word Bahubali doesn't occur anywhere near in this snippet. So overall, when you run your model, you have your features, this kind of entity gets a very low score. On the other hand, when you have the right translation, where roles is mapped to the type actor, Prabhas is connected to the type actor and is also mentioned in web text along with other query words, and then there are a lot of such text snippets. This happens quite often, which is why Prabhas gets a much, much higher score than, let's say, a solder. We also compared with related work. There are many research groups working on similar problems. These are some of the examples of recent works where they used only the knowledge graph for question answering. So much of this work is about KG-based question answering. And also they depend on the syntax of the question, or that is the natural language grammar of the question, to come up with the right translations. So those approaches work well for queries where you have nice formulations, you can depend on the grammar, but it fails when it comes to the keyword queries, which we see in web search usually. So it turns out that in 3 out of 4 query sets, our model was doing right. And in the 4th query set, it was still doing better than most of the approaches. All right, some examples of wins and losses. So we found out that as I mentioned before, some of the queries are easier to answer with web text. So fastest ODIs, double century is one of the examples. But precedent sworn on airplane, or who was the first US president ever to resign? These kind of queries. Sometimes these answers are not present in the knowledge graph, or sometimes landing to the right translation of the query, which will give us the answer on the knowledge graph, is very difficult, which is why using web text we were able to do better. On the other hand, sometimes we found out that using web text was actually leading us to wrong answers. So creator of the Daily Show, it turns out that there are too many snippets for the wrong answers coming from the web documents than the right answer. So this is one of the cases where we felt that we have to strike the right balance between the knowledge graph and the web text. Just using it blindly doesn't always work. So we now come to the final two slides. So the insights that I got from all this experience is that one is question answering is a hard business. We have made some progress, but there are still many complex multi-step kind of questions which current models are not able to answer. So to give you some examples, companies that make fanless motherboards or cities where Einstein taught, right? So here you have to go through multiple steps. Such as X is a motherboard, X is fanless, and then there is company Y, which is making X, right? So you have to go through all these steps to land to the right answer. Achieving this translation is difficult. either on the graph or the web text. Right? So these are some of the questions which is still in future. We found out through our experiment that both these web text and knowledge graph make very nice complementary information sources, because knowledge graph is structured and accurate, and it has, but it has low coverage. At the same time, web text, it has high coverage. Of course, we are using all the data that is there, but it introduces some noise. Right. So striking the balance between these two is very critical. So one last slide. This was all about open domain, right? What if you have a closed domain application? So this still works for you. So suppose you are doing corporate or enterprise search. So you have corporate hierarchies of which teams, which managers, which peers for people, maybe some keywords on how, what they are working on. And you have in parallel their wikis and internal data, which works as plain text. You can just use both of these together to do a better enterprise search. Similarly, if you are doing product or e-commerce search, you have a nice product catalog, but at the same time, you have user reviews as well. So again, you can combine these two to do better search. So that brings me to the end of the talk. Thank you very much. These are some of the papers that have come out of this research. Feel free to look at it if you are interested in more math or more details. So we can take questions.
Thank you, Uma. Can we have a round of applause, please?
Thank you.
To the people who are standing at the back, I'm really sorry that you had to stand through the talk, but I'm really happy for you, Uma, that you had like an amazing house, full house for today. Okay, so we can take some questions now. Also, if anybody is feeling reticent to ask questions, you can feel free to like tweet it, and I'm happy to read it out on behalf of you. You can just use the hashtag Fifth Elephant. Okay, questions.
Hello, Uma.
Okay.
Yeah. Hi. So is the order of the words matter in the current research, what you had done? So like lead role in Bahubali instead of Bahubali lead role.
Right. So to a large extent, so I started this work with using only keyword queries. That time our purpose was that order should not matter at all, right? But then I came to the conclusion, and in more recent years, I figured out that keyword queries are not the only queries we want to handle. We also want to take into account the query grammar when it is present. So in summary, the system should be able to make use of the grammar when it is present, but not depend on it, because we also have keyword queries. So which is why we sort of outsource this work to the deep neural networks, where we are making sure that we provide nice balanced query data coming from both keyword and natural language queries.
Hi, Uma.
Yes.
Hi. So in using the combination of two methods, is there a significant performance overhead that you face for search queries like this?
Not significant. There is yes, there is some certain performance overhead, but thankfully both IR, which is the document search, has come a long way. Of course, we can make use of index caching and maybe pre-compute some queries. We can do some tricks like that to make this practical.
Yeah. Hello. Yeah, Uma. So I have one question. So when you talk about entities, so I think ontology also plays a big role there. So you would have usually preferred term and you know, like associated terms to build that, right? So one of the challenges when we try to adapt the public tools for building the you know, knowledge graph, what we often face is the missing terms along with the ontologies. So do you think any of the these public sources give that agility for us to, you know, add more and more entities? Is there any faster way? Because it's always a very time consuming process.
Sorry, is the question how can public publicly available graphs give you the freedom to add more entities?
Yes.
So each of these public sources
we use, by the way, semaphore is like one of the entities this thing,
right.
but it's like very time consuming when you want to add more entities, right? So is there any quicker way you think that can be handled?
So I have seen that mostly it goes through a crowdsourcing plus some sort of supervision kind of process. So you would make your suggestion, but that would go through a review to make it into the knowledge graph. So yeah, there is some flexibility, but it's not very straightforward.
Hey, Yuma.
Hi.
So my question is, when we work with such knowledge graphs, sometimes the timely manner fashion means what happened in 2011, let's say some theory that has been proved wrong in 2015 or something. So these type of things, like who is the president of US, we need the time for that when I'm searching. So such queries, how it can be handled with
right. So we are assuming that that kind of information is available in the knowledge graph. To give you an example, Yago, that's one of the knowledge graph we used earlier, that has actually come up with these kind of time based facts. So yeah, or if it is mentioned in the web text, we'll be able to make use of it. But we are not doing any kind of specific checks on top in our model to make sure that temporal facts are getting covered. We are assuming that the knowledge graph. Follow up, we'll take that later.
Just a second. How many people have questions? Can you please raise your hand? 1, 2, 3. Okay, 3 questions. We can do that, right? So, one right on top. Yeah.
Hi.
Vision part. Okay. Am I audible? Yeah.
Yeah.
So, can you elaborate a little on the weak supervision part? I mean, because I have come across this for the first time. So, I want to know what it is, maybe a couple of sentences, and how, what was the relevance? What boost did we get out of it?
Right. So, just I'll give you a quick answer because this is a very long question. We can take it later. By weak supervision, I meant that you do not have very fine-grained supervision of this is the right translation, this is the type, this is the entity, this is the relation. That kind of translation is very hard to come up with. What we could do is, given this query, this is the answer, right? So by weak supervision, I meant that we are missing the intermediate step. We are going directly from query to answer. And which is why in our model, it's also we are not taking that intermediate query translation as we are keeping that as unknown. We are taking a max over that. But more details, I think we should discuss later.
So Mahai, thanks.
Hi.
So 2-part question. One is you used web text to augment the knowledge graphs answering capabilities, right?
Yeah.
How would you compare that with an approach where you use web text to augment the knowledge graph itself and then ask questions over it? The reason I'm asking this is because sometimes you know, having a huge corpus of documents, particularly in domain specific cases, is hard, right? So web is kind of a happy case there that you have lots of documents.
Right.
So that's one part of the question. And in some sense, related part is how do we make best use of what parts or what types of queries are best answered with the knowledge graphs versus documents?
Okay, we'll take the second part offline. For the first part, yes, there are approaches which do this. We have the knowledge graph. You would take some text or some description, go and append it to the knowledge graph. So this is not like you have the whole web text with you while doing question answering. But just maybe some snippet, high quality snippets. The advantage you get out of this is you are only doing question answering on the knowledge graph, so it's going to be faster. You have a little more flexibility than before because maybe you added some semantics or maybe you added some new facts which you could answer. But you lose the extra flexibility that you get when you have the whole web text with you, right? So if you are thinking about this from head and tail queries, right? There is a long tail of queries. You are losing flexibility here. You are doing better in the intermediate area.
Makes sense. Thank you.
Do more people have questions? Just we have one question here. I'm afraid we're running out of time. Do you mind taking it offline? Is that okay?